copy today is the guy you want to talk to and hear from. And any question you may have, tweet us, because this guy can answer it. Leslie Stokes, Officer of the Order of the British Empire and Chairman of the British Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines, is on Hot Copy today. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Karen.
Okay, now, I'm curious. Why is the world fascinated with a royal wedding, specifically in London? I mean, because there are other royal weddings, but people are not as fascinated with the others.
Well, this, of course, is the old British Empire. At one point, Britain owned half the world, and plus the fact that English is the language of the world, or the business language, so this has got the big romantic touch to it.
Okay.
I think the other thing is, of course, after what happened with Charles and Diana, this is the revitalization of the monarchy for the 21st century. So I think they're very, very happy about the fact of making this such a big event.
Now, why is Great Britain still keeping the monarchy?
Oh, I think there is no question the monarchy has always been the integral part of the United Kingdom and the British Empire in the old days. I think that now is pretty secure. It went through a very bad trough in 1936 when King Edward had to abdicate because he married a divorcee.
Just the King's Speech, the movie.
That's right. King Edward's the older brother. He married Wallis Simpson, the American divorcee. So suddenly King George VI became king, not expecting to be, with two little daughters. Of course, the eldest was Elizabeth, who's now the Queen. And then we went through another trough, of course, in 1981. That was the marriage of Charles and Diana, but subsequently, of course, the obvious fact that it was a marriage that was very disconnected.
Okay.
And, of course, the famous statement when she said to the press, there were three people in the marriage, when
yes.
everybody then realized the real love of Charles's life was Camilla Parker
yes.
Brooks. And so that marriage, of course, divorced, and then the tragic death. So that was a real low for the monarchy. And there were questions then, would it survive? This is the big revitalization of the monarchy. The 20th century has gone. The 21st is there. We have a young woman who's a commoner, who comes from a middle-class background, and a young, handsome prince who obviously looks like his mom, so that legacy is there
yes.
as well.
You know, I didn't even know that Prince William, or a prince, can marry a commoner.
Oh, yes. But going back...
What are the rules?
There are really no rules. They
okay.
actually have evolved over time. There was always the issue of a prince or princess marrying a divorcee,
which
was why the problem with Edward, King Edward, because of marrying Wallis Simpson, the problem with Princess Margaret, the Queen's sister, wanting to marry her, the love of her life, Group Captain Townsend. So there is a problem, but as you know now, with the Queen's four children, three of them are divorced and remarried. Charles is married to Camilla, and Andrew hasn't remarried, but he was married to Sarah Ferguson.
And divorced.
And Princess Anne, of course, was married to Captain Mark Phillips, which the two children are hers from Captain Mark Phillips, but she's now married to someone else.
Okay.
So
yeah.
It's not so much, but it's always the question when the son and heir to the throne, who's the potential king or queen, the divorce issue always becomes another problem.
Okay, now let's do a comparison. What would you say is the major difference between the marriage of Charles and Diana and William and Kate? You were telling me a while ago.
Yeah, I think it's very different. First of all, of course, Charles was in his early 30s and Diana was 19.
Yes.
Diana was not a highly educated person. She hadn't done advanced education at university.
Okay.
She never went beyond, yes. you know, sort of 16, 17 pre-college education. And
Diana didn't go to college?
She went to pre-college, but she then became a prep school teacher. She never actually went to the next level of college or university.
Okay.
And so she was very young. There was a 11-year, 12-year difference in age. She was a fairy tale princess. She was beautiful, but she was not really protected and ready for the royal family, even though she had a status of lineage.
Yes.
Here we have a woman who is the same age as William. They're the same age. They went through college, university. They went to St. Andrews. It's clearly a love match. They're both of the same age. She is a 21st century woman who you could meet in any street in Britain, a middle class, brought up girl, who everybody can identify with, all the young people. So there is a big difference
yes.
between them.
Are they both turning 30?
They're both 29.
Okay.
They'll be 30 next year.
Okay. All right. And what about the love angle? I mean, many people are saying that the first problem is Charles didn't really love Diana when William really loves Kate.
Yeah, that was the thing. I think with hindsight, everybody will say we realized that right from the start. Of course, we didn't. Clearly, Diana was in love with Charles. No question about
really?
It. Right from the start. It was her dream story, and you know, she was going to be the fairy tale princess and then eventually the fairy tale queen. But I think when you look back, it was patently obvious that Charles felt that this marriage had been pressured on him because he was the heir to the throne. His sister had got married, his brother was getting married, he wasn't. And
yes.
they were looking for progeny, obviously, to the next generation. And so she appeared to be the perfect queen, the beautiful young princess. But there was clearly a disconnect. They didn't have the same interests. And as we now know, he really was in love with Camilla Parker Bowles.
Yeah, it's
all
amazing.
Along. Yeah, and she'd gone off and married somebody else, of course,
yes,
and had children
yes.
herself.
Yeah.
And that's the other big issue, because Charles is the heir to the throne. Whether the British public would ever accept Camilla being called Queen Camilla is still very much
yes.
open to doubt.
Now, is Prince Charles still eligible to be king?
Absolutely. He is the heir to the throne. He is the eldest son of the Queen. If the Queen died or retired, because she's 85 years old,
yes.
she was 85 last week, if she retired or died, he would become king. But there's very big questions about whether the British public could really accept Queen Camilla.
Yeah.
But if the Queen stayed on for, say, another 10 years, that would take it to 95, Prince Charles would then be in his 70s. So that would maybe the big question mark is, could it jump a generation?
Could it?
It can, yes.
Who dictates that?
Well, the Queen may well give the instruction if she retires or she dies, there may well be some arrangements with the son, with Charles, that would jump. Maybe he doesn't want to be king. He's waited 60 years, by then he'll be in his 70s.
Yeah.
So I think there is a real expectation it could jump the generation. That's why there is so much interest in this marriage, because William is the heir to the throne next in line after Charles, but it could jump the generation. And she, of course, there is no problem about her becoming Queen Catherine.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is the dream that the British public can see, the monarchy surviving and going forward.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
that's the difference.
And many people were saying that it came to a point, at some point the British public didn't want to spend for the monarchy anymore, but with this wedding, they now feel they want the monarchy to stay.
Oh yes, I think there's no doubt that it's been a tough economy over the last two or three years, and I was listening to your reporter saying earlier from London
yeah.
That everybody's got to be careful that they don't see it as too ostentatious. It's going to be a grand occasion, and I don't think any of the British public mind that. But you can't be seen to be throwing money around when people are suffering from high taxes and out of work problems. But I think the beauty of this one is that the way it works now with the royal family, there is a civil list. This is the money that the taxpayer pays to support the royal family.
You're serious?
The civil list is now much, much smaller than it used to be. It only goes down about three or four or five levels. Queen, the princes, the princesses. But it doesn't go down right the way down. For instance, Princess Anne's kids are, you know, work.
Yes.
They have to work. So the civil list has been curtailed quite a lot, so it's only the first three or four tiers that get funding.
So, I'm curious, for it's £1, right? You use pound?
Yes, the British pound. Yes.
Okay, the British pound, how much of £1 goes to the monarchy?
Oh, you can't actually calculate it in that. A very small percentage, a very
okay.
small percentage.
You can't even feel it?
No, I mean, it's really, they reckon that the cost of this wedding to the British taxpayer per individual is very small.
Okay.
But they mustn't be seen to be too over the top because of the economic struggles at the moment in the
okay.
UK, people out of work and everything else. But I think deep down, the way it's built up over the, particularly over the last month, everybody's now saying, this is the real feel-good factor. Let's spend some money. The other thing is everybody forgets the actual cost of the wedding, whether the Queen pays some, Charles pays some, the taxpayers pay some. The income that the British economy is going to get from this just over this weekend, from the tourists, the hotel bills, the air flights, the hospitality, the souvenirs, is phenomenal.
Yes.
And the advantage for British business overseas, it's a great showcase for British business overseas and the way we run things.
All right. Now let's talk about the wedding itself. What are the protocols of the wedding? Okay, she arrives at 11.
She arrives at 11. It's an absolute standard wedding, as you would see here in the Philippines, except it's an Anglican wedding, not Catholic. He will be there at the front with Prince Harry as the best man. The Queen and the Prince Philip will be there. Her family will be on the other side of the aisle. And she will enter, followed by the maid of honor and the bridesmaids. I think her sister is one of them. And then up to the altar, the Dean of Westminster will conduct the part of the service, and then the Archbishop of Canterbury is the head of the Anglican Church in the Church of England. He will